Praise God. I don't know about you, but I'm going to make it after all. After all of this life is over, won't have nothing more to worry about, nothing to fret over. Why? Because I'm going to be with Jesus. How do I know? He said I could. He said, whosoever calleth on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And so, you see, whenever we call on the name of Jesus, there's just something that takes place down there under about the fifth rib. My. And so, you see, God loves you unconditionally. And he calls to you and he says, come unto me, all of you that are laden and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. He says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will be added unto you. So you see, a lot of times, yes, I know we have our problems. Yes, yes, we stumble and we fall, but we don't have to lay there. We get up and go on, because we don't gain a thing if we just lay still. But if we'll get up and go on, and I look and see what caused us to stumble and fall, then perhaps we won't stumble over that same stumbling stone again. That we'll have our eyes on Jesus. Our hands will be up, looking unto him, the author and the finisher of our faith. Well, I praise God today. I want to send it out to those that stands behind us, helps us out time and time again. We just praise God for you. You know who you are. And so you see, and if you don't, you know who you are. I don't, but you do. And you know the thing about it, God does too. And so I'm grateful for what the Lord's doing. So my prayer is that God will just bless you and your spirit will be lifted up. You can go down the highway of holiness rejoicing because you know that you know that you know your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And so I know today, without Him, I couldn't do anything. But with Him, all things are possible. So we don't want to say hi to Ruth. Roscoe and Wilder are not with us tonight, but we thank God that Sister Nancy is able to come. We've got Ron standing here. He'll sing us one directly. So you just pray that God would have His way in our hearts and in our lives and mind that we'll be able to do all that God wants us to do. I want to remember Brother Larry Helmick in our prayers tonight. Mind that God would just reach down and touch him. I want to say hi to Faye. And there's lots of others out there that we'll say hi to. Remind you that, no, we haven't forgot you. We just don't get around as much as what we used to. We move a little slower. Takes us a little longer to get there. And so, you see, I'm glad for what God's doing in people's hearts and lives. I believe that Jesus is coming back real soon. And if He'd come back, if He'd come back tonight, would you be ready or would you not be ready? I want to send a broadcast out to those that have lost their loved ones. And there's heartache and there's sorrow. But, you know, it'll happen to us. And one songwriter come along and he says, maybe it'll be you and maybe it'll be me. But you see, we just don't know. But we do know that if we leave this old world, if we're ready to go, when our name is called or our number is pulled, whichever way you want to put it, then we've got a better place to go. A place where we won't be sick anymore. Well, a place where there'll be no more heartache and no more sorrow. No, there won't be no more death. There won't be no undertakers or no doctors or hospitals. Why? Because people that live there don't die no more. And so, you see, I'm looking forward to it. That's right. I'm making preparations. And as I tell people so much, you know, heaven is a prepared place for prepared people. And if you're not prepared, you can't go. That's just that simple. Well, what do you do to get ready? Jesus told Nicodemus. Nicodemus was a man that was well thought of around Jerusalem. And he didn't really want anybody to see him coming to talk to Jesus. So he come after night. And whenever he come, he looked at Jesus. And he said, how can a man enter into his mother's womb whenever he's old and be born again? Jesus says, you're not getting the point. That's our old translation. You're missing the point. Why? Because you take an unregenerated spirit, don't understand spiritual things. And so today is the day of salvation. Jesus loves you. I don't care what you've been into. Don't care how ornery or how mean that you've been. There was a fellow walked up to me one time. He said, preacher, can I go to church here? I said, yes, you can. He said, I'm mean. I'm ugly. I said, don't bother me a bit. If Jesus can put up with you, I believe I can or I can try it. And so you see, God loves you. God loves you unconditionally. And so we need to get ourselves in condition that if He would call us, we would be ready to leave. We would be ready to leave. I'd like to pray with you and pray for you that God would just reach down and touch you. I want to pray for Edie and Robbie too. so many people out there that we love, that mean so much to us. And so I praise God. I just praise God for the opportunity to be here, to let our voice ring out across the airways to encourage you. And just look into that camera and say, if you don't quit, God won't quit. You heard me right. If you don't quit, God won't quit. What do you mean? I mean, we might stumble and fall. The Bible don't teach anything about the sinless saints. Not a thing. Why not? Because there's not any. He said, we've all sinned. We've all fell short of the glory of God. And so, you see, that's the reason that he gave us 1 John 1:9. Why? Because he said, if you just confess your sins, I'm faithful and just to forgive you and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Jesus loves you. Father, in the name of Jesus, reach out today. Touch those under the sound of our voice. Believe God that a lot of people that are lost and undone without hope. I pray, Heavenly Father, that they'll feel the love of God beckoning at your heart. And they will realize that that's a call coming from you. You're no respecter of person. You saved one ornery, low-down, drunk, you'll save another one. If you saved one that was addicted to drugs, you'll save another one. And God, we know. We've seen him saved. We've seen him delivered. Seen him set free. And so I'm praying today, God, that people will take you at your word. We thank you, Lord, for what we can feel. We thank you for what we know. And I just pray, Father, that you would have your way in our hearts today. God, touch those that are sick. God, that has lost the determination to get up and to move around. Heavenly Father, that you would just reach out and touch them, God. That they'd have such a desire just to get up and to dance a little bit. Yes, you said the Holy Ghost, I would set our feet to dancing. And so I'm praying, Father, that it shall be done. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, that people will not be ashamed to confess, I've received Jesus as my personal Savior. I'm not ashamed of the blood that is shed on the cross of Calvary. Done it just for me. He who knew no sin was made sin, that I could be made the righteousness of God in Christ. And so, Father, have your way, and we'll praise you and thank you in the name of Jesus. All right, Sister Nancy, you're going to come back, sing us another song.
I'm so glad that his blood's on my soul, and I'd like to send this out to Mary and Bob tonight if they're watching. Dear Jesus, all my sins forget and washed and made me whole. I have sweet peace and joy within. His blood is on my soul. His blood is on my soul.
Praise God. All right, Brother Ron.
How can I give thanks for the thing you have done for me? Thing so uncertain, yet you gave to prove your love for me. The voices of a million angels could not suppress my gratitude. All that I am and ever hope to be, I give it all to thee. To God be the glory.
Yes.
To God be the glory. To God be the glory for the things he has done. With his blood he has saved me. With his power he has raised me. To God be the glory for the things he has done. Just let me live my life, let it be pleasing, Lord, to thee. And should I gain any praise, let it go to Calvary. With his blood he has saved me. With his power he has raised me. To God be the glory for the thing he has done.
Well, praise God. I know, that God's still God. I don't care who you are. I don't care what you've been into. God will save you if you'll just ask him to. But you've got to ask him to. And I know and I realize tonight that there's lots of people that go to church has never had an experience with Jesus Christ. You say, well, how do you know? Because they don't have a testimony. Honey, when God saves you, you've got a testimony. Now, that's all there are to it. You know when it happened. And you know where it happened at. You know what God done for you. And you know where God brought you from. You see, that's what it is. That's a testimony. Telling people, sharing the story of how I got saved. Where that God brought me from. Honey, listen. When I got saved, I wasn't nothing. I was nobody. But you see, when God saves you, God makes something out of you. I listened to a preacher last night bear witness. And I know there's a lot of people who says, well, I don't understand. Why? Because Jesus' name works. The name of Jesus works. And it doesn't make any difference. You know, Jesus said that whenever he come back, not everybody that says, Lord, Lord, is going to enter into the kingdom of God. And there's, he said, there'll be people come up and I say, well, now, Lord, I cast out demons in your name. I've done many wonderful works in your name. You see, it wasn't what they done, it's what the name of Jesus done. And as I listened to a man testify last night about these two young fellers had got together over in Peru, and they were going to college. One of them was a Muslim, and the other one was an American. And the young fellow that lived in America, the one that was an American, he was a Christian.
And he talked to this young fellow that was a Muslim all the time about God. And he said that they would have some of the greatest talks about who was really God, whose God was really real. And this boy, that young fellow that was from America, he says, "Now, I know that God's real. There's no question about it. I know that God's real. I've seen things that God has done." And they was going to college together. They roomed together. They were good friends. Even though they had some deep discussions, they were still good friends. And one day, there was a fella came by, and he told this young fella that was from America, he says, "Now, there's a person up here, up the street, that has got a demon spirit, and they want somebody to come and to help with it. They need help because this person is about to lose it. And the only thing that will stop it is when people begins to pray, begins to seek God." And then that spirit will settle down. And he said, "If I go, I'm not going to be satisfied with just the spirit settling down. I want the spirit to leave, to go." He says, "So doesn't other people." And so the young fellow started, and he turned around and he looked at his buddy, and that was a Muslim, and he says, "Are you going with me?" He says, "Yes, I want to see this." And that the young fellow that was from America looked at him and he says, "Will your God kick out a demon spirit?" He said, "I don't know. I've never seen it done." He says, "I've seen my God do it, because my God lives. He's a living God." And so they went up the street to where this person was at, and there were several people there, and they were trying to hold this person down. And this young man from America, he went in and he anointed that person and they prayed for him. And it didn't work. And he backed up and he looked at him and he says, "Just wait a little while. I'll be back. I'll go get some reinforcements." He said, "I know where there's other people at." And so while he was gone, they looked at this other young man and they says, "Well, how about your God? Will your God do it?" He says, "I don't know. I've never tried it." They said, "Well, try it." And so he prayed in his God. And he in the name of his God, he called that demon spirit to come out. And he said, the demon didn't come out. But before the man got back, that fellow that was a Muslim, he says, "I'm going to try his God. I'm going to try the name of Jesus to see what happens." And he says that Muslim laid hands on that one that was demon spirit, that had a demon spirit. And he said he prayed, and whenever he prayed, he said, "Now in the name of Jesus, come out of there." And he said that demon spirit come out. And that person that was demon possessed stood up or sat up and smiled. And whenever the young fella came back from America, they looked and they said, "What happened?" And they pointed their finger and says, "He done it." He looked at his buddy and he says, "I didn't do it. I called on Jesus and Jesus done it." Honey, can I tell you today, Jesus is real. Jesus is alive. You say, "Well, I've never seen anything like that." I haven't either. But you see, it's not God's fault that we haven't seen it. And most of the time, it's not God's fault because we don't pray for people like that. Everybody's afraid of them. But you see, Jesus is not a bit afraid. Well, I didn't know I was going to get into that, but I did. And so I want you to know today what Jesus done for you and I on the cross of Calvary. Whenever he was made sin for us, that give us the liberty. You see, he says that whenever it was finished, he broke down the middle wall of partition. The scripture says that the veil in the temple was rent from top to bottom. You see, that veil was in that temple to keep everybody out of the holy place. The only one that could go in there was the priest, the high priest. And he only went once a year. And whenever he went in, he had to make sure that he was clean. And whenever he went in, they tied a rope around his foot just in case something happened to him. That he didn't walk back out. They sat and listened because he had little bells around the tail of his skirt. That whenever he walked around, they could hear them little bells dingling. And they knew where he was at. And what he was in, what he was doing. And he would go in and put blood on the mercy seat. Well, I praise God. And whenever he would do that, you see, then he would come out. And the people was covered again. And so that's what happened, you see. But I want you to know today, honey, Jesus took the place of all of that. And we don't have to go in the temple anymore. All we have to do is call on the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, as the Apostle Paul teaches us in the 10th chapter of Romans. He said, if we'll just call upon him and believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, and confess with our mouth that God lifted him up, he says, you shall be saved. And so today, if you're not saved, it's not God's fault. Honey, have you called on the name of Jesus and said, Lord, forgive me of my sins and my iniquities. Cleanse me from my unrighteousness. I realize that I'm a sinner and I want to be saved. I want to be the righteousness of God. And Jesus, I will forgive you, and he'll write your name down in the Lamb's Book of Life. And honey, I cannot tell you something. From that on, you're the only person that can take it out. And nobody else can do it. I know we like to blame people a lot of times because we drop out of church. We turn our back on God and we go in the opposite direction. But we're the only one that can blot that name out of the Book of Life. And so you see, Jesus wants to save you today. Today is the day of salvation. Father, reach down. I touch in a mighty way. I set the captives free. I deliver the oppressed. I heal the sick. Open the blinded eyes. And my people have joy. Instead of chaos in their hearts and their lives, might their families be happy instead of fighting all the time. Give us directions, God, and we'll praise and thank you for it all in the precious name of Jesus. God bless you. Is our prayer until this time next week.